got vetoed in Arizona. Mike Pence at that signing ceremony just signed it, making Indiana the first state in the country to move overtly, wholesale, on purpose, to legalize and say the state approves of businesses refusing service to people on the basis of sexual orientation.
The governor's position makes no sense. He wants to have it both ways. Change the law, but not admit it was wrong. Sorry, governor, the whole country knows this law was discriminatory.
Back now on America's Forum, you heard a couple of comments from MSNBC. First, Rachel Maddow, and then Al Sharpton, talking about the implementation of Indiana's religious freedom law. Now, some of the criticism, and there was a lot of it, it wasn't limited to MSNBC. In fact, there was a lot of coverage of this that had more to do with sexual orientation and less to do with the goals of the law in terms of asserting religious freedom. So suffice it to say, there are problems that we can catalog, and here to go in depth and analyze some of the media coverage of this story, we're pleased to welcome in Matt Philbin, the managing editor of the Culture and Media Institute at the Media Research Center, as he Skypes in from the MRC studio in Washington, D.C. So, Matt, you guys have done a study about media coverage of this religious freedom law. What did you find in the study?
Well, we looked at the top 20 newspapers in the country, defined by circulation, and found that 12 of the top 20 had weighed in with editorials on the RFRA. And of those 12, only one, the Wall Street Journal, supported the law or defended the law. One, the New York Post was mocked the outrage over the law, but didn't weigh in one way or the other on its merits. So you have a situation where 10 of the 20 top newspapers in the country are uniformly condemning a law that 50%, according to Pew, that roughly 50% of the population supports. They're calling it bigotry, they're calling it homophobic, they're calling it anti-gay. Their disdain for Mike Pence and for the legislature of Indiana is palpable, and it's a terrible example of the groupthink that really is ascendant in our elite media today.
So, look, newspapers have the right to editorialize, and they do so all the time. I think what's concerning here is, let's take, for example, I used to represent Arizona. The Arizona Republic is an unabashed supporter of amnesty and open borders. Are most newsrooms, most newspaper editorial staffs overwhelmingly leftist and always viewing things through a leftist lens, whether it's the open borders notion or so-called homophobia?
Oh, absolutely. Look, the only diversity they cannot get behind is diversity of opinion. You have basically people from the same essential upper middle class background, went to elite liberal arts colleges, went to journalism school, which is one of the worst places on earth to go if you want to learn how to be a reporter. And they are engaged in groupthink. They don't understand what the rest of us how the rest of us think, how the rest of us feel, and live our daily lives.
Well, mindful of that, and this is the real danger, Matt. The editorial page is one thing, but when that editorial outlook goes over and crosses the hall into the newsroom and there's an agenda on what's supposed to be who, what, when, where, and why, and instead it becomes an interpretation or an oration against a certain policy, that's where the problem is.
Well, that's right. And one of my favorite things, Washington Post does this all the time. They call it news analysis. Basically, it's an op-ed on the front page. That is, it's editorializing. It is supposedly giving, an in-depth analysis of a story, but it's just more opinion.
And we thank you, Matt Philbin, for your unvarnished analysis of what's going on at some of the major newspapers in the country with reference to religious freedom. Matt Philbin, Skyping in from MRC in Washington, D.C. Hour two of our program coming up.